Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will learn about the Fourier series. So in the previous video, we had seen that from the communication perspective, it is very useful to know the frequency spectrum of the any signal. For example, if we look this signal in the time domain, then except the few things, we can hardly tell anything about this signal. But if we see the frequency spectrum of this signal, then we can say that it contains the frequencies from 0 to 3 kHz. So many times, this information in the frequency spectrum is very useful. So using the Fourier analysis, we can find the frequency spectra of the any signal. And in this video, we will learn about the Fourier series. So the Fourier series allows us to represent the any periodic signal by the linear combination of the sine and the cosine waves, which are harmonically related to each other. Now, if the periodic signal is continuous time signal, then it can be represented by the continuous time Fourier series. And if it is a discrete time signal, then it can be represented by the discrete time Fourier series. But in this video, we will talk about the continuous time Fourier series. Now, I am sure most of you are already aware about the harmonics, but still let us quickly go through it. So the harmonic is the integer multiple of the fundamental frequency. Let's say we have one sinusoidal signal which repeats itself in the one time period. So the frequency of this signal will be equal to 1 by t. And let's call this frequency as the fundamental frequency. Now in the same time period, if another sinusoidal signal repeats itself two times or completes the two cycles in the same time period, then we can say that its frequency is 2f. And this frequency is called the second harmonic of the fundamental frequency. On the other end, in the same time period, if another sinusoidal signal repeats itself three times, then we can say that its frequency is equal to 3f. So using this Fourier series representation, any periodic signal which has a time period t can be represented by the linear combination of the sine and the cosine waves. So here, this omega naught is equal to 2 pi divided by t. So here, when n is equal to 1, then the frequency of the cos and the sine wave is same as the fundamental frequency. And as the value of n increases, then this cos and the sine wave represents the harmonic frequencies. So here, this particular Fourier series representation is known as the trigonometric Fourier series. Because here, the signal is represented in the terms of sine and the cosine waves. For example, if we take the example of the square wave with some frequency f, then it is composed of the sinusoidal signal of the fundamental frequency and its odd harmonics, like the third harmonic, the fifth harmonic, the seventh harmonic and the so on. So here, the amplitude of sine and the cosine wave can be found from the Fourier series coefficients. So here, these a0an and the bn are the Fourier series coefficients, and these coefficients represents the amplitude or the weightage of the sine and the cosine waves. For example, here a0 is the DC component and it can be found from the following expression. Similarly, the an and the bn can be found from the following expression, where n is varying from 1 to infinity. Alright, so now let us understand why this trigonometric Fourier series is represented in this particular fashion. Or in other words, why any periodic signal can be represented in terms of the linear combination of the sine and the cosine waves. So the thing is, the sine and the cosine waves are the basis function, or in other words, they are the orthogonal signals. And using such orthogonal signals, it is possible to approximate any signal. So first of all, let us understand the concept of the orthogonality. And let us see, using this orthogonal signal, how we can represent the any particular signal. And to understand that, let us take the vector analogy. So let's say we have one two-dimensional vector g and we want to represent this vector in terms of the another vector. Let's say the another vector is the x. So we can approximate this vector g as cx, where c is some constant. Now here, the value of the c could be anything. So if the value of c is small, then the cx would be small. Let's say if this vector represents the cx, then the error in the representation of the g will be this much. Let's call this vector as the error vector and let's call it as the e1. On the other end, if the value of c is big And let's say this vector represents the Cx, then in that representation, this will be the error in the representation. Let's call this vector as the E2. So as you can see, if we take any value of the C, there will always be an error in the representation. So this error vector E will be equal to G minus Cx. Now here, the magnitude of the error would be minimum when we take the projection of the G on the X vector. So geometrically, the magnitude of the component of the G on the X will be equal to G cos theta, right? And we can say that it is equal to C times X. Now if we multiply both sides by the X, then we can write it as G times X cos theta is equal to C times X square. So from this we can say that C is equal to Gx cos theta divided by X square, right? So here this Gx cos theta is the dot product of the vector G and the X, while this X square represents the dot product of the X with itself. So this expression shows that if we select the value of C using this formula, then the error in the representation of the G will be minimum. Now here, this is the value of the theta, right? But if this theta is equal to 90 degree, in that case this cos 90 will be equal to 0. Or in that case we can say that this dot product of the G and X will be equal to 0. So if that is the case, then we can say that the vector G and the X are the orthogonal vectors. That means for the orthogonal vectors, the dot product of the two vectors will be equal to 0. So in this way, we can represent the any vector in terms of the another vector. And the same analogy can be used for the signal also. So let's say we have one signal G of t, which is defined over the time t1 to t2. And let's say we want to represent this signal G of t using the another signal. Let's say this approximation is equal to C times X of t, where the X of t is also defined for the time t1 to t2. So in this case, we can say that the error signal E of t is equal to G of t minus C times X of t. Now similar to the vector, here we need to find the value of the C in such a way that the error in the representation of the G of t is minimum. That means for the best approximation of this signal, the error should be minimum. So this error is minimum when the energy of this error signal is minimum. So here, the energy of this error signal can be given as integration t1 to t2 e square t dt. Now here, let us put the value of E in this expression. That means the energy of the error signal will be equal to integration t1 to t2 g of t minus c times xt square dt. Or we can say that the energy signal is equal to t1 to t2 g square t minus 2 times c times xt times gt plus c square times x square t dt. Now here, we need to find the value of the C in such a way that the energy of the error signal is minimum. So for that, we need to differentiate this expression with respect to C. Or in other words, this dE divided by dC should be equal to 0. Now here, since this term is integrated over the time t, so we can take this differentiation inside this integration, right? So we can write it as integration t1 to t2 d by dc times g square t minus 2 times c times g of t times x of t plus c square times x square t dt. Now here the first term will be equal to 0, right? And from the second and the third term, we can write it as minus 2 times integration t1 to t2 g of t times x of t dt. While from the third term, we can write it as 2c times integration t1 to t2 x square t dt, right? And to find the minimum value, we should equate this expression with the 0. So here, these two will get cancelled out. And from this, we can find the value of the C. That means to minimize the error, the value of the C should be equal to integration T1 to T2 g of t times x of t dt divided by integration T1 to T2 x square t dt. So to minimize the error, this should be the value of the C, or in other words, for the best approximation of the signal, this should be the value of the C. Now here, if we compare this expression with the vector analogy, then the numerator represents the dot product of the G and the X vector, while the denominator represents the dot product of the vector X with itself. So in this way, for the any given signal, if we select the value of C in this fashion, then we can minimize the error in the approximation. So I hope this point will get clear to you. Now let's move to the vector terminology once again. Now so far, this two-dimensional vector G was represented using the single vector, right? That means here we have approximated that G is equal to C times X, or in this case, let us say it is equal to C1 times X1. And we had seen that with that approximation, at the most what we can do, we can minimize the error, but the error would remain there. For example, if we select the value of C1 in this fashion, then this will be the error in the representation. But suppose if we represent this vector G using the two vectors, then we can remove the error. For example, now if we represent this G as C1 times X1 and C2 times X2, and if we select the value of this C2 times X2 in such a way that it is equal to E, then the error in the representation will be 0. And since there is no error, so instead of approximation, we can write this G as C1 times X1 plus C2 times X2. Now here if you observe, these X1 and X2 are the orthogonal signals. Because if we take the dot product of this X1 and X2, then it will be equal to 0. So from this we can say that if we represent the two-dimensional vector using the two orthogonal vectors, then there will be no error in the approximation. Similarly, if we represent the three-dimensional vector using the three orthogonal vectors, then there will be no error in the approximation. Or in general, any n-dimensional vector can be represented by the n orthogonal vectors without any error. So the same terminology can be also applied for the signal also. So let's say we have a set of the orthogonal signals starting from x1t, x2t to xnt. And let's say we are representing one signal g of t, which is defined for the time t1 to t2 using this orthogonal signal set. Let's say the g of t is approximated as c1 times x1t plus c2 times x2t plus cn times xnt. So in this case, the error signal e of t will be equal to g of t minus summation of n is equal to 1 to n cn times xnt, right? Now here, if we want to minimize the error, then the energy of this error signal should be minimum. And here, we can minimize the error in this approximation by selecting the value of cn as integration t1 to t2 g of t times xn of t divided by integration t1 to t2 x square t, where n is varying from 1 to n. So by selecting these coefficients for these orthogonal vectors, we can minimize the error in the approximation. But here, as n tends to infinity, that means as we increase the set of the orthogonal vectors, or in other words, as the orthogonal set is complete, then the error in the approximation will be 0. So if we have a complete set of orthogonal signals, then this signal g of t can be given as c1 times x1t plus c2 times x2t plus cn times xnt plus so on. So in this case, this representation is the equivalent representation of the signal g of t. That means in other way, when we have a complete set of orthogonal signals, then we can represent the any signal g of t using these orthogonal signals. Now if we take the any cosine wave and their harmonics, then they are the orthogonal signals. Let's say we have a one signal cos of n omega t, and the another signal is cos of m omega t. where omega is equal to 2 pi divided by t. Now, if we multiply these two terms and integrate them over the one time period, then it will become 0 when m and n both are different. On the other end, when m is equal to n, in that case, this integration will be equal to t by 2. Similarly, if we take the case of the two sine waves, let's say sine n omega t and sine m omega t, and if we multiply these two terms and integrate it over one time period, then it will be equal to 0 when m is not equal to n, and it will be equal to t by 2 when m is equal to n. So you can see that the sine wave and the harmonics are also orthogonal signals. So here the sine of n omega t and the cos of n omega t represents the complete set of orthogonal signals. And using this complete set, we can represent the any periodic signal which has the time period t, because here this omega is equal to 2 pi by t. So using this particular orthogonal set, we can represent any signal g of t which has the time period t. And that is how we have arrived to the expression of the trigonometric Fourier series, where any periodic signal is represented by the linear combination of the orthogonal signals. So here, this a naught will be equal to integration 0 to t g of t times 1 divided by integration 0 to 2 1 square dt, because in this case this x of t is equal to 1, right? So if we integrate this term, then we will get 1 by t integration 0 to t gt dt. So that is how we got the expression of the a0. Similarly, an can be written as integration 0 to t g of t times cos of n omega t divided by integration 0 to t cos square n omega t dt, because in this case this x of t is equal to cos of n omega t, and here n is varying from 1 to infinity. So as I said earlier, if we integrate this term, then it will come out as t by 2. So from this we can write this an as 2 by t integration 0 to t g of t times cos of n omega t dt. So that is how we got the expression of the coefficient an, and likewise we can also find the coefficient bn. Now if we plot these harmonics, then it shows the contribution or the weightage of each harmonic in the particular signal. So here the plot of the an versus frequency shows the contribution of each cosine wave in the particular signal. Similarly, we can also plot bn versus frequency. So it shows the contribution or the weightage of the each sine wave in the particular signal. So in this way, using this trigonometric Fourier series, we can find the different frequency components in the particular periodic signal. So I hope in this video, you got the brief overview of the trigonometric Fourier series. And I hope you also understood the concept of orthogonality using the vector terminology. So in the upcoming videos, we will discuss the exponential Fourier series. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.